Let's go over. I'm Yann. I'm developer on the API. I'm joined with Richie, also developer on the JavaScript API, and we're gonna go over the how to build interactive client-side apps. I mean, building client-side applications in general without really going back to a server. And we'll go over the different APIs that we have for this in this release and the upcoming ones. All the slides are available on this URL. If you want to take a picture, it's now. And the also the demos I'm going to show are also over there. I will show some links to the new SDK. I will update them as we release 4.11. All right. Also, you will get this as part of the proceedings after the dev summit. Okay. So agenda is pretty small. It's we're going to go over the different client-side applications and layers and so on. And then we're going to show some couple of demos at the end about how to build interactive charts using the client-side query engines and engine. All right. So in the JavaScript API, you have three main client-side layers that process features. We have the CSV layer to read a CSV file and then expose the features. We have the new GeoJSON layer in 4.11, and also the client-side feature layer, a feature layer that you instantiate with features instead of a URL to a feature service. Then we have client-side query capabilities, and then in 4.11 we'll have filter and effect. Okay, so I'm gonna go over the CSV layer now. So, can everyone read? Is it big enough? Is it okay in the back? Okay. All right. Whoa, my code is. Anyway, yeah. To create a new CSV, to create a CSV layer, basically you can just instantiate the instance and then pass the URL to a CSV file. But then also you can specify some attributes, some properties like special reference. So this is pretty, it's a tip for you if you know that the map view will be in certain special reference. It's interesting to set right away the special reference when the CSV layer will be read. Then the data will be immediately projected and stored in the special reference that you have specified. You can also specify the delimiter, so in between each column, which delimiter to read. You can specify the field to use for latitude and the field to use for longitude. So the CSV layer can we only support coordinates in longitude and latitude. And then you can specify the object ID for the field, the name of the field that will be used as object ID. By default, it's underscore underscore object ID. I mean, it's that's the current value. When we read a CSV layer, we do infer most of this information. We check different possible delimiters, and we pick the one that we think works. And also for latitude and longitude, we have a set of possible values like lat, long, latitude, longitude, and so on. So here I'm opening the API reference for the CSV layer. So we'll find links to the different samples, but also like the different properties. Whoops, this one is very small. But also the different properties I just mentioned. So, yeah, for example, this is the latitude field doc will tell you which fields names we currently like automatically detect. Same for longitude field. We have also a sample using CSV layer. This one is in 3D. So it's again earthquakes. I'm sorry, it's been a theme for the entire conference. this is a demo from last year's Dev Summit plenary. So this one shows you drag and drop experience. This demo is also available on GitHub. There is a file for earthquakes, and then we drag and drop it, and the CSV layer is parsed. I don't remember how many points there are, but it's quite quite a lot. What the CSV layer does also is inferring the, sorry, I lost my train of thought. Yeah, we try to parse the number as best as possible, and we are trying to, we parse it also local aware. So for example, in the US, the decimal separator is a dot. But in France, for example, we use the comma. So if we, if the local is French, we'll try to first use parse float in JavaScript to find the numbers, or we'll use the local number parser. It's very, I mean, it's pretty unique because in general, the libraries out there that parse CSV, they only, they assume that that the numbers are written in English. What's very nice also about this demo is that you can execute some client-side querying. So in this case, I will show you the code for that, but there are multiple operations happening at the same time in that circle. I'm looking for the strongest the strongest hurricane, and then I'm also asking for all the points, all the features that belong to that hurricane, and then I use the highlight API to highlight all the features belonging to a particular hurricane. Let's go quickly over the code for this. Poop, poop, poop. So I built for this particular demo, I built a drop target widget. It's that widget that appears on top of the view when you drag and drop the CSV file. It's this guy. And so this this widget, it creates a CSV, it will call this function when a file is dropped. And then this is the data transfer object coming from JavaScript when you drag and drop a file. And then I create a blob URL, I create an object URL from the, that file. And this is what I, this is what I pass the layer to the layer. So you can pass a URL that is of a CSV file that is in a remote service, but you can also use this technique to pass a file reference. And then if we go, if we scroll down and we find the query features, so I'm using query features on the layer. So we have this client-side query engine for the on the layer view, but for those client-side layers, we also have the query feature. We, it's like this client-side query engine is also used for those client-side layers. So you can directly query on the layer, and then I'm passing the search area, which is that circle, under my pointer, and I ask for statistics to get what is the maximum win speed. And then when I get those statistics back, I get my maximum win, and then I ask, okay, what are the, in that circle, what is the what feature actually has this maximum win value? Then I'm asking for the serial number, which is a field identifying the particular earthquake. When I get that, I'm returning the max win and the hurricane name, serial number. And then I query for all the object IDs that, that has that particular serial number. So now I will get all the different point, individual points for that particular earthquake. And then I remove the current highlight and I call highlight on the layer view to highlight those particular features. Right. Let's close this. Oops. All right, so the tips, again, specify the layer special reference if you know that you're gonna work in one special reference. Otherwise, we store that in WGS84. The data, and so the layer view will reproject on the fly as we ask for feature tiles. And then you can use data URLs, blob, you can use blob technique to pass a CSV that you have either generated or that you have downloaded already as a string before. So here I have my CSV. I have the sales number, I do zero, but Richie is over 9,000. Whatever. And then, and then we have the latitude field, longitude field. So I create a new blob with my CSV data. I specify that the type is plain text. I create a blob URL using create object URL. I pass the URL to my CSV layer. I load the layer. And then when this is done, I'm revoking that particular URL from memory. Next, the client-side feature layer. So it's like a feature layer, but instead of specifying a URL, here I'm specifying a source array, which has three graphics in this case. And then I specify the geometry type, specify the special reference of my data, the object ID field, and the fields that are part of the features. If you don't specify any of these, we will infer those properties from the data that you have specified. So I will look up for something called object ID. If I don't find it, I will try to find a field that you have specified with the type OID. And if I don't find anything, then the layer rejects, and you get an error. I also get the geometry type, if it's point, and so on. Main benefit of using a feature layer over CSV, for example, is that CSV only stores point data. But in this case, I can have polygons, polyline, anything I want. The benefit also of using the feature layer over using a graphics layer is that you get access to those query client-side query functions. And so that's I added a link in the slides to the documentation to the sample that shows how to create a feature layer with client-side graphics. Again, earthquakes. It's actually earthquakes dataset that comes from USGS. It's a GeoJSON feed, but then it's converted inside the application to client-side graphics. It was made by Christian right there. And then, so we specify here the list of fields. So if we know them in advance, it's better to specify. So like that, for example, numbers, you can, like time, you can specify that it's of type date. For me, like when I look at your, the graphics that you specify, I will just see a number. So if you want to specify that it's a date field, then it's better to do that, to specify the type. And you want to do that because after in your pop-up template, then the date will be formatted into your, the local. Otherwise, it will be considered as a number, so you will just have an integer instead. Then here we have the pop-up template with the field infos, the renderer that we want to apply. So any of the client-side layers, they have exactly the same API, so you can specify renderer that uses visual variables, span mapping, and so on. So here we get the data, we create the graphic, create the layer, create the legend. We get the data. It's so we fetch the feed using S3 request. And then when we get the response, we create all the graphics by going over the GeoJSON data. So you will see later that the GeoJSON, I mean, this is easy for points because the GeoJSON for points is pretty simple. But then when it comes to point polygons and polylines, consuming directly GeoJSON is it's slightly more complicated. And then we create the attributes. Once this is done, once we have all the graphics, we just like create the feature layer with the fields, object ID field, like I said, the renderer and pop-up template, and the graphic source. All right, onto GeoJSON. And finally, we are adding GeoJSON layer in 4.11, coming this month. Let's go over. So this is the new documentation for the CSV layer. It's still ongoing. And then we have like some description and some limitations I'm gonna go over. Nothing really surprising here. It's still the same API, so we have like labeling info, specify labeling, specify the elevation info, specify the renderer, and so on. So all those three layers, they have the same API surface, so it's great for you. So like that, you can build. You don't have to know whether or not this layer supports something or it doesn't support it. You just if the layer has query features, you can assume that that it works. Consistency. This is a sample again, earthquakes, but now we consume directly. We got earthquakes all along. So we have this this feed. So instead of being a CSV feed, now it's a GeoJSON feed. Just want to attract your attention. In 4.11, the SDK will have links to all the URLs, so you can command click and open the links there directly. It's pretty nice. And it's also going to work for portal item IDs. If you do a new feature layer with an item ID, the item ID will be clickable, and you will be redirected to the ArcGIS.com page for that particular item. So new GeoJSON layer, and then yeah, we just added and it works. What's nice about also all those client-side feature layer is that they work in any projection when displayed. So let's say I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna remove that, and then I'm gonna say I want my special reference here. I want here to be some French stuff. 2154. I think it's that. Oh, yes. Good catch. Of course, my base map won't work. Okay. Right. So, well, we don't see France here, but yeah, you have to imagine that France is right there. And no, I don't know if it's. Where it does, yeah, it seems like this is like South America and then California here, I guess. Well, yeah. All right. I have some other examples afterwards. So, yeah, that's the feed we are consuming. They have like feeds from the past, updated every 15 minutes from the past 30 days. You can like pretty much like already choose whether or not. If you want all the earthquakes or just a subset. And also, let's take a look here because it's going to be my next point is that we, sorry, trying to zoom. So, what's really nice about that feed is that they documented every field, so you know what is the type. But then also something very interesting about GeoJSON is that there is a spec, but not everyone. I think there is like just a few feed that actually that are compliant. In this case, for example, the depth is expressed like the altitude is expressed in depth. So instead of going up positively, it's going positively down below the surface. So if I would display this. This GeoJSON layer straight into a 3D scene, all the earthquakes will be above ground. So I'm going to go over that right after. So you can also specify the layer spatial reference to indicate to the layer in which spatial reference you want to store the feature. And same, so it's a limitation in 4.11. You won't be able to directly pass a GeoJSON object to the GeoJSON layer. You can only specify a URL. So same technique as CSV. You can create a blob. You stringify your GeoJSON object, and you create a blob saying it's application JSON. Create the blob URL. Pass this URL to the GeoJSON layer, and revoke the URL when you are done. Okay. Yes. So let's go in. Sorry, I went in a different order. So in this particular feed, the elevation is expressed in, oh my God, my code is wrong here. The elevation data is in kilometers, but it's also going in the wrong order, in the wrong direction. So we use the elevation info on the CSV layer to specify that the unit is kilometer, that it's an absolute height, and then we give an arcade expression to access the Z value of the feature and just multiply by minus one. And now it's going to go in kilometer, like negatively. So it's going to display just fine in our 3D scene. Sorry. So this is the plenary demo about that. And so we have this the earthquakes there, and then if we set the elevation info, now they are underground, but we can have them like correctly placed in space. There are some very interesting area also in California where there are like a cluster. It's pretty neat. And then if we go underground, yeah, so that was the last part. We can specify the simple renderer like any other 3D layer and give it a point symbol 3D. I want to have a sphere for my symbol, and then two visual variables, one for the color, one for the size, and I will use the magnitude field to size and colorize the earthquakes. Oops. Recently, there was a big one in Peru, or I think Peru. So it doesn't show up. It's hard because those earthquakes are. The spheres, they are in one, they change size as I zoom in and out, right? So anyway. Okay, so just some information about the implementation and the limitations. So we followed the implementation of the spec that is defined by the RFC 7946. You can look up for just the GeoJSON spec, and then you will find quickly you will find this this spec very easily. It's pretty interesting to read. We support only feature GeoJSON features and GeoJSON feature collections as a top level GeoJSON object. We fix the winding order. Pretty much every polygon layer that I found was not correctly setting the like serializing the ring, the coordinates in the rings. They were not in the correct order, so we fixed that. Yes, so to be consistent with the all our feature layers, they only have one geometry types, so we don't support feature collections. GeoJSON feature collections where you have points and polygons at the same time or whatever. It's like it's only points or it's only polygons. What we do though is like if you specify the geometry type on when you create the feature layer, the CSV layer, sorry, if you say if your GeoJSON has point and lines, let's say, and then you create your GeoJSON layer saying that the geometry type is polygon, I will only look at the polygon geometries, the features with a polygon geometry, and ignore the ones from like the lines, for example. We don't also support the CRS object. So in GeoJSON, you will only specify geographic coordinates in longitude and latitude. We also don't support crossing the dateline. So if your geometries are crossing the dateline, going from 170 to minus 170, so it crosses the dateline that we don't support. You have to make sure that your geometries are properly cut at the dateline. On the maybe pile, geometry collection, pretty sure that we can support easily. So we would generate features for each one of the geometries in a geometry collection. Topo JSON we could support. I don't think it's would be a big deal. According to the spec, the object IDs can be strings or numbers. We only support numbers at the moment. It's an extensive change to support strings, but maybe. Actually, that earthquake feed, the IDs of the earthquakes are strings. So we ignore them and we generate new object IDs on the fly. Not supported yet, but we probably will, for sure, I guess. export back to GeoJSON. Right now, you can query features. You can only get like graphics in our format. Updating features directly using GeoJSON, being able to add GeoJSON features, remove GeoJSON features that we don't support yet. You have to go through the apply edit, which accepts graphics. So, like I talked about already, we don't support yet loading directly with a GeoJSON object. We will. Web map spec, and also I want to support specifying query parameters. So, for example, if your GeoJSON, if you have an endpoint that has that returns GeoJSON, and if you want to pass parameters to the when we make the query, you will be able to specify some query parameters. And also, refresh is not yet supported. So to sum up, like all the implementation uses of the client-side feature layers, they all use the client-side query engine. So you can rely on the query features to be exactly the same as you want. Pick the best for your usage. I guess I would prefer you to use GeoJSON over CSV. CSV, the problem is it's only text, so I don't know if it's a string is a number, so I have to infer that, and it's very heavy on the CPU. Yep, add the proper attribution also when you use GeoJSON feeds like that from USGS. Make sure that you read what is the licensing and properly set the copyright value. When you use a feature layer coming from a feature service, we get the copyright from the portal item by the author or from the copyright property on the service. So you might think that you can replace your feature layer with GeoJSON. You shouldn't. It's a big no-no. And I have a demo for that. So here I have the cities of France, and I have, so it's an extract from OpenStreetMap, and I have combined these features with statistics from the National Institute of Statistics for France. So it's rather fast, but then like when loading this app, you can see here that I have 43 megabytes of data. I cleaned up already the GeoJSON. For example, the coordinates that were coming from the extract were at like 10 or 12 digits after the decimal separator. It's way too much precision. You don't need that. So it was over 100 megabytes. I removed that and I arrived to 43 megabytes. So this is some of the consideration. The same layer. So I took that GeoJSON and then I went on ArcGIS.com. Uploaded the GeoJSON layer and created an hosted feature service. So it's now a feature service. And now instead of bringing back 43 megabytes of data for the same startup location, it's only 1.4 megabytes. So much more interesting. Also, one thing we do with the feature layer case, when we go to the service, we only query for the fields we need for display, whereas the GeoJSON, you get what is in the GeoJSON file. So if you have like 20 fields per feature, then you get like much more data. Yes, also we use quantization on the server side to limit the number of vertices that we get back. When you are at, I will reopen this GeoJSON. So same, the problem with GeoJSON is that you will get the features in the full definition as they are specified in the file. So that's why also it's 43 megabytes. So if I zoom in, you can see like the quantization happening, but like it's very defined. So I have all those vertices. Whereas if I'm at this level, you know, I don't see any of these. You know, it's like it's too small. So the feature layer instead fetches the feature in a simplified form using the geometries in a simplified form using the quantization. It's roughly the same speed. We have to improve the drawing speed here. It's kind of annoying, but as I zoom in, now you the quantization also happened, but now it's like fetch on the fly. It's really fast. And we only keep the data that we need for display. I haven't showed that here, but then same API is also for labeling. I'm labeling the, this is where I come from. I'm labeling the city name. Also, this demo is pretty nice because it's using the smart mapping module to generate an above and below visualization of the median disposable income in 2015. And it's exactly the same API. It's exactly the same app in both cases, in both the feature layer and in the GeoJSON case. The only difference here is that it's GeoJSON data. Oops, it's not the right app. This guy. Just to show you, I'm using the color smart mapping creator. So I added the attribution for OpenStreetMap and the Institute of Stats. I've set my labeling info to specify the max, the mean scale for the city labels to 500,000. The labeling arcade expression to return the name of the city, and then the text symbol for that. And to invoke the, I load the layer, and then once it's loaded, I call the create continuous renderer on the field I want. I want an above and below theme, and then I get the renderer. I remove the outline. I'm not interested in that, and there also, and then I set the renderer. So same app in both cases, just that this is a client side data. If you want to take a look at more info about quantization and how it we reduce the number of vertices, I have this app available also on GitHub. It just shows the different level of quantization and the number of vertices that we get. For example, quantization, when we send a quantization to the server, we get back 30,000 vertices. And then if we compare on the client, so now I downloaded all the full data set in the full resolution. I get 112,000. And then if I quantize client side, which we do for our GeoJSON, for example, we remove like a bunch of those vertices. So as we increase the quantization, this is a quantization at 1 pixels. So all the vertices that are on top of each other that are at a specific view resolution like this, all the vertices on top of each other are removed on the fly. But we can increase that quantization, for example, to take a look at different levels. So here I'm a quantization of 2 pixels. And then if we go to 4 pixels, we can see like some, it becomes like very blocky. And then we can go all the way to 32 pixels. That was for the, now we barely recognize anything. But then with the amazing benefit that we get only 600 vertices. And then the last stage is pretty abstract. Right. So yeah, just to summarize on this, the client-side feature layers and client-side feature layer views, they use the client-side query engine capabilities. So you get query features, query feature count, query object IDs, query extent. Now on to filter. So that will be released with 4.11. It's a new API to be able to filter features very quickly using that client-side query capabilities. You define a feature filter on the layer view, and all the features that don't pass this feature filter will be hidden. So you can specify an attribute filtering using the where SQL clause. So here, whatever. And then you can specify a geometry, a relationship. So all the features that are contained into my polygon, And then you can also specify a distance and with a unit. So we will create on the fly a buffer around the input geometry of 10 miles and then use that as a filtering. When you do a filter or when you do client-side querying in general, it's always good to do a special filtering because we remove a lot of feature using a special filtering compared to a where clause where basically the features are specially indexed in memory, but for attribute right now, we don't have any attribute indexing. So we're gonna scan through all the features attribute to check that each feature pass or not the where clause. Remove this. So this is the new API that our colleague Andrew is working on. She has done a great job on putting a lot of details there. Especially, I asked her to document the special relationship. We had this very brief documentation on that, but now she documented and she worked with the creative labs at Esri to come up with illustrations to really understand what a special relationship means. So intersect, let me get that bigger. It's really cool. So intersect, you have the the filter geometry that you pass, or the query geometry that you pass, and that here is the data that is in memory inside the feature layer or GeoJSON layer, and then you can see if it has this green border, it means that the feature is returned. So intersects a point with a polygon. This one you will get. This one you won't. And it goes over like the different ones and all the subtleties, like for example, contains a line that overlaps another line completely will be contained and so on. So I think that's a great documentation about like to try to understand like what's the best fit for the needs. This documentation for the special relationship also will be available in the query special relationship because it's exactly the same. Okay, and this is a sample that we ship that will ship with 4.11. So here we have Hurricane RV, and these are gauges of the total, like the measured rainfall for each gauge. And then, as I move my slider, we update the feature filter to filter the features. And so, yeah, she creates here the filter on the fly using the total and then the filter that we want. Neat little sample. And then also we have this new sample. I will open it in the main. Which is like kind of a way to explore the different spatial relationship by geometry. So here you can say, you can define, you can click on those buttons to show different feature layers with different geometry types. It doesn't matter what is that visualization, just like the geometry type. And then what geometry type you want to filter with or query by, you know. So you, let's say I want to have point data and I want to query spatially with a polygon, and then I can specify intersect or contains. Well, in this case it's the same. Then we can play with the other ones. And then you can also specify a buffer, so you get like live feedback about what would be the geometry that would come back, what geometry the client-side query engine generates from the input polygon plus the distance and the unit. I can say it's in meter, I can say it's in kilometer. So of course, it's much harder to get right, and then we can clear. So that's also a new sample coming with 4.11. And we have also effects. So it's built, once we built the feature filter, we were like, okay, cool. We can remove, show and hide features. But then sometimes, we may not want to hide them, but instead, de-emphasize the features that don't pass the filter or emphasize the features that pass the filter. So we came up with this new feature effect API. So you build a feature effect setting, so you're creating the feature effect, and then that effect has a filter. So you can have a filter on the layer view plus an effect on the layer view, and the effect as a filter itself, and you can define same attribute filtering, geometric spatial filtering, and then after you can specify the excluded effect or and the included effect. So the excluded effect will be applied to the features that don't pass the filter of the effect. And the included effect will be applied to the features that are passing filter. We currently implemented the following functions. I will go over them in a second. This string is basically inspired by the CSS filters. I will show that in a moment. And you can combine the different functions together. So we have like brightness, contrast, grayscale, hue, rotate, invert, opacity, saturate, sepia. We get all of them from the CSS. We just don't have blur and drop shadow yet, and it's not. We probably will. Not in the initial release. And also we want to enhance this set of function with other ones like scale. So let's say you want to scale the features that are passing an effect. So if you want to do like a mouse over effect, you would specify an effect where the feature gets bigger when you are hovering them, and rotate and transform, I guess. So if you don't know about CSS filters, those are the MDN has a great documentation about that, them, and also a playground where you can play with them and update the different parameters of the function. That's about it. If you are interested into how we did that, I have the code of the parser that parses this this CSS filter string. It's using PEG.js. It's a language a library to create a parser. So I won't go into detail, but it's just if you are interested into how to build your own parser, PEG.js is also the library we use to parse the where clause that you specify in your client side queries, but also it's used to parse the arcade scripts that you specify that you use. Yep. All right. And then this is the doc for effect. Notice it's going to ship in beta in 4.11. The reason is that we want also to work with on the 3D side of things. So we want to get feedback from you guys. If it's a good API, if it's limited in some fashion that we haven't seen. So it might be subject to, it will stay. It just might be subject to modifications for 4.12. A property that I'm not showing off here is excluded labels visible. So you will have control over whether or not, if you have labeling set on your layer, you will be able to decide whether or not you want the labels of the excluded features to be to disappear or to stay in place. And we have the different. Doc, we will also come up with a set of recommendations. Sometimes if you use included effect and excluded effect at the same time, it won't look great, so we will come up with a set of recommendations for you guys. All right. Okay. So this is a GeoJSON. So it's actually two GeoJSON now. The polygons here are coming from the Natural Earth project. Let's go natural. It's a project that publish lots of different data in GeoJSON, and it's on GitHub here. So you have the boundaries of the countries. You can have also the land, or here the earthquake, the airport. I mean, too many earthquakes. The bathymetry lines and so on. So pretty good resource. So I'm pointing to one of those feet directly, and I'm saying that I want to display in the Equal Earth projection, the newest projection, and then also I have the earthquake feed on top. So let's take a look at the effect. The filter first, yeah. So I can really like quickly like filter like the features that don't match my my filter. So here I'm just doing it by magnitude. And then the effect, you can specify. So in this case, I specify a grayscale and opacity. And then that all the earthquakes are visible on the screen. It's just that they are gray, and so what's nice here is that you can see like some sort of shape of like here, like definitely the earthquakes are much deeper in the crust, well, below the surface. So that opens up, I think, like a bunch of new types of user experiences. We haven't like really wrapped our heads around it, but it's going to be interesting. And finally, I want to put all of it together. Sorry, zooming in and out, it's kind of annoying. Like, the definition is very big. So we have this layer of plant powers. They are colored differently based on the type of the power plant. And so we used client-side querying to be able to make this kind of queries where I create a circle geometry. Could be here, this is a circle geometry, but it could be also query by distance to achieve the same thing. And all the features that are inside are, we don't specify any effect, but all the ones outside, they have an effect defined. We're gonna take a look in a moment. And then as I move my, my buffer here, you can see that the chart is updated in real time, and I show the sum of the of all the power plants that are there, and show like the capacity in megawatts. Okay, let's go over the code here. Very quickly on this. So I'm using the sketch view model to draw that circle. I'm also defining the different fuel types that I will display in the chart. I create a chart using chart.js, and then I on create on the when the create event fire from the view model, I will just select the features that are inside that circle. And so this is the select feature. I create a query using the layer create query. This is very handy because if the layer has a definition expression, the query that it, that is returned here has the definition expression already set. I'm specifying the geometry of the, so that circle, and then I want to get the sum of the capacity in megawatt for all the features that are inside the circle. But I want to have this these statistics grouped by the fuel type. Right, so so I will get different values for each one of the different fuel types, gas, nuclear, and so on. And also I apply the effect I was talking about. So in this case, yeah, again, grayscale works great. You can specify other ones like let's try sepia. Oops, this. And same geometry, same workflows, and so now like all the features outside they are in this old school look, and then I could also do differently. I could specify just the filter, just to not show the features that are outside. You can yeah, oops, this. Yeah, and now all the features that are outside disappears. And finally, I get the statistics. I format the statistics by in the format that Chart.js expects, and then I update the chart. And voilà. And now, Richie is gonna talk about time. We just had a session about this. So, but yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Jan. That's a good introduction. So at 4.11, we're introducing basic support for time. So as of 4.11, if you connect to a feature service, you'll now see another property called time info. And that time info has information like a start and end fields that will be used, but also the extent, the temporal extent of your data. And another class we added is time extent. Again, it's used by the time info, but more importantly, it's now used by queries. So we can use queries with time extents to apply filters. This is an example of a query where it's both a time query, but also a attribute query with a where clause. And there's numerous ways of using time-enabled queries. You can use it on a server site that's making a request to a server, like give me a number of features that satisfy this query, or download the features for this query. But you can also do it client side. So features are already downloaded in the browser. I can perform queries against those features, like what you saw with Jan earlier. I'll leave the last two because we've already covered them. But you can use the same queries as filters, but also effects. So I'm going to show a quick demo of using a time-enabled query. Again, this is earthquakes, again.
I'm sorry, it's your demo.
So I'm going to grab this time slider. I'm only interested in quakes. And I'm using a Mac here, so I'm sticking with time here. And as I drag my mouse across the screen, it's doing two things. It's selecting, or it's querying, client side, all the earthquakes that are large, greater than magnitude of 5, that were after 1970 or 1960s, but also within 500 kilometers of my cursor, my mouse cursor. So all three things are done client side, selecting those earthquakes and highlighting them on screen, but also using those features to update the chart in the bottom of the screen.
And is this available?
Yes, yeah, this is all open source. It's there'll be links to it on Jan's presentation. I'll go back to slides. So to quickly go through the code here, it's very simple. The first thing we do is we need to grab the layer view. For client-side stuff, we need to have the layer view. And then building a query. So I'm using the create query method because that returns the starting parts, the query, that also automatically includes a definition query. And then adding the time component based on the user-defined sliders, and then specifying the position of the cursor on the screen and map coordinates. And last argument there is quite interesting. It's a new property we added to query, and that's our return query geometry. So in the results that I get back from the client-side query, includes the geometry, that circle you saw. So I'm using that circle, the query geometry, to draw a white circle on the screen. That's the 500 kilometer radius. Next is, again, we're using the features that are returned from the query to highlight them. And the last component is just iterating through all the features and adding a cyan dot to the chart. In fact, that's the slowest part. If it wasn't for that chart, you could have hundreds of thousands of earthquake points. I think that's it.
Yeah.
Are there any questions?
No, so it's just that the input data needs to be, there is nothing past the deadline. Something that passes the deadline is on the other side. So it's just that your lines needs to be cut at the dateline. So at the maximum, it goes at 180, and then you stop your vertex there, and then you have another vertex that starts at minus 180. Well, it works. It works continuously. It's just that there is nothing beyond the dateline. So we cut the geometries are automatically cut. But then when we render, we stitch the data from one side of the dateline to the data to the other side of the dateline. You know, like for example over here, you know, like the points that are over here, they are in a minus 120, and then here they are like at 170, like those points, right? Sorry? Yeah, you make two tracks. You cut the line at the dateline. Your track at the dateline, and then you start over from the other side. The reason is like if I can't assume that the geometries are valid, it will be way too much processing to process every single geometry. So it will take forever to load. Basically, yeah. Yeah, I can put that back. They are already online. All the links to the demos, the links to the API SDK form 4.11 won't work, but I will update the slide as soon as we released. Any, yeah?
Does the CSV layer support CSVs that are included in the zip file yet, or are there any plans to do that?
So does like CSVs inside the zip file? No, it's not supported. If you want to do that, you have to use a zip library and request the zip file, inflate it, and give us the CSV data directly. Yeah.
On the timing format, so if the data is coming from another source, should the timing to be GMP, specific time format, zip format?
Should the time data be in a specific form, a time zone, and so on?
Ideally in UTC.
Yeah.
For ArcGIS Online, it assumes that the data is in UTC, so we're going to follow the same pattern. Otherwise, it gets very complicated.
Yeah, so this is just not supported at the, for this release, but then for the next one, there is that backlog of features. I had to stop to prepare my dev summit. But the idea is to be able to specify some query parameters so that, let's say, your GeoJSON endpoint has accepts some parameters that you want to specify. You will be able to specify that. And then you will be also able to set a refresh interval in seconds, and or call the refresh function to refetch the whole GeoJSON. Yeah. Any other questions? Huh? No, don't have. Yeah. Stream services are hard to have because they are very resource intensive, so we don't even have that. Yeah, cool. Well, what I mean is like in general they are not public. So in general, those stream services are not made public. They are behind, you know. Yes, there is one. Yeah, there is just, yeah. That's a good point. I forgot about this one. So yeah, if you go into the samples and then you type a stream layer, you will find this one. But I think this is like fake data. It's just or replayed data. It's always the same that comes back. But these are I think buses in the LA area. All right, enjoy the party, it's 6:30. So, yeah.